This week, the voters of Norway said no to the common market and no to the Prime Minister, who had fought so hard to bring them into it. Prime Minister Trygve Bratteli and his Labour government had promised to resign if they lost the common market referendum. At 1:30 on Tuesday morning, as the results on television swung towards no, he made his first admission of defeat at his party headquarters.
Well, I am disappointed that it isn't a better conclusion of this referendum, certainly.
Do you think it's been a healthy thing for Norway to have had a referendum?
That is a matter of dispute. I think it was a dispute about this before it was decided to have a referendum, and I think this will make stuff for discussions for many years.
It seems to have been a rather bitter campaign.
Certainly, and I think that is one thing which is bound up with referendum, that the political discussion will be more bitter than ordinary political discussions.
Bonfires and torchlit meetings marked the closing night of the No campaign. The fires, which common market supporters bitterly resented, were a reminder of Viking days, the ancient symbol that an enemy was at hand, that the country was in danger of betrayal. Never in the 67 years since Norway won her independence from Sweden has any campaign aroused such intensity of national feeling. The message on the banners was a simple one: stem nay, vote no. No to the common market. No to the policy which successive Norwegian governments have worked for 10 years. In the last 2 years, the People's Movement Against Membership has gathered 130,000 active workers drawn from all parts of the country and from many conflicting shades of opinion, as political scientist Henry Valen explains.
Well, there is a strange alliance here. We have an alliance between, on the one hand, the radicals in the cities and the farmers and fishermen in the periphery. These two groups constitute the core of the opposition against the common market. Most in favor of the common market, then, are the majority of the Labour Party and the Conservative Party, these two main antagonists in the political system, together with their supporting organizations in economic life. The trade unions on the labor side, of course, and the management organizations on the conservative side. These main antagonists they agree now about joining the common market.
At a street meeting in Oslo, government speakers made a last-ditch appeal for popular support. Although a referendum was not legally necessary in Norway to decide the common market question, the Labour government made it quite clear that they would accept the verdict and resign if the answer was no.
Det som taleren eller det som spørgeren sikter til, det da en forskjell.
But the Labour Party itself was split, with supporters and opponents of the common market arguing against each other in the name of socialism.
I think you have to look at the values that the European community are trying to realize. And I think that is the values that are against the interests of the majority of the Norwegian people. It's against the values of the workers, of the fishermen, of the intellectuals and of the peasants. And therefore I'm voting now. Some years ago I would vote yes, but now I'm voting now.
I think that the present European community represents very little in terms of values, but what I really think is that the community may be a means to forward and promote the aims and the aims and to solve the tasks which we see need to be solved, but which really cannot be solved only by action of one nation alone.
Well, I cannot understand that people that are calling themselves socialists are voting for the European community. I'm very afraid that the European community will develop into a superpower and that they will try to have the raw materials from Africa and other countries, because it's not a great many raw materials in the European community. I think that the United States and Soviet as superpowers are better conditioned in that way.
I think there's a basic disagreement as to what is socialism here. I'm also a socialist, but we believe in socialism in terms of international cooperation too. It appears that he thinks that we can govern, guide, control our own country if we stay alone. Now, the realities of the situation is that we belong to an international economic community. 40% of our brutal national product comes from economic contacts with abroad. This shows that employment, growth, a live economy in this country is dependent upon economies of other countries. Now, this means again that we do not really control and guide our own destiny only by working inside Norway and inside any country for that matter alone. There must cooperation, we must create cooperation at the economic international level in order to be able to control economic developments at home as well.
As the people of Norway attended church on Sunday morning, before the polls opened, there were many for whom economic arguments came a poor second to more deeply held beliefs. The established Lutheran Church did not officially exhort the voters one way or the other, but particularly in country areas, fears had been expressed that common market membership could lead to infiltration by the Roman Catholic Church. Worse still, that the Antichrist predicted in the Bible and the common market itself were one and the same. Even to more moderate Lutherans, their religion is bound up with their national identity. Norway, with less than 4 million people, is, after Iceland, the least densely populated country in Europe. And her population is increasingly drawn away from the remote rural and coastal districts into the towns. It was these districts, like the area around Tromsø in the north, that were to give the common market a resounding no in the referendum. Voters here, especially fishermen and farmers, have heard too much about plans for regional development and seen too little action. For them, even Oslo, their own capital, is a far-off bureaucracy, not over-concerned with their welfare. Brussels, as they see it, would care even less. The fishermen were unimpressed by the Norwegian government's assurance that their interests would be protected in the common market. For 10 years, a 12-mile limit would keep other common market boats away from vital areas like this. But after that, there was only a promise to look at the question again, not the cast-iron guarantee they wanted. The fishermen's opposition was a basic one, concerned with livelihood, not ideology. And their suspicions of the market were reinforced when the Minister of Fisheries himself left the government in protest against the eventual terms. The fishermen, backed by farmers, were ready-made supporters of the curious alliance which the people's movement built up against the market. Often, the no votes in rural areas were canvassed and confirmed by young people who might equally be expected to demonstrate against the Vietnam War or South African apartheid. The common enemy was centralized power.
We are afraid of the problems in our regions. If you take a map of Norway, a map of Europe, you will see how we are placed in the outer part of this big common market. I think we will see, as my friend here says, that there will be a movement. It will be a danger, at least, that workers of Norway will Firstly, they might be forced to move to the common market, the center of the common market countries, to get work there. And also, we will see in our own country an even stronger concentration in the big cities than we have now.
One of the most energetic factions of the No movement was a women's group, which attracted members from left, right, and center. Their determination to say no was matched by their belief in the value of a referendum.
I also should like to mention that a long-range effect of this is a new political interest in the country as a whole. And I met a trade unionist the other day who said to me that the best thing he thought had happened was that people now thought that they could think as well as their leaders. They didn't want to take or their opinions from the top people in the labor movement and in the trade union anymore. They really think that they can do the thinking for themselves. I think that's a wonderful thing to happen in a country.
But surely there was a Gallup poll that suggested that only 20% of the people even knew what the countries of the common market are. Now, doesn't this suggest that a referendum is maybe misguided?
It is right. It is right to have a referendum in spite of that fact, because that is not the issue. It isn't a knowledge test. I think that what has been the good thing about this is that people understand that democracy is action. It's not political programs and nice big talk. It is action here and here, exactly here. And about the knowledge issue.
You would really say that this referendum represents a people's movement against those in power?
Yes. Those in power... Well, I would have to think a little about that. It's quite a big thing to say, really. But it's the elites within many of the parties, and also part of the government, all the mass media, or most of them, are for the common market. So partly I would say that your characteristic is right.
If people feel that they can't handle their own life, that they can't make decisions that are essential for their own welfare, then it becomes extremely difficult to survive and to keep sound and healthy. And in some way I feel that this has also something to do with our country. If this country doesn't feel that it can handle its own affairs, that it will be directed from other sources outside it, it isn't a sound situation for a country. But I agree with you, and I think that we must work together with other nations. And the first step for me would be very natural to work together with the other countries in Scandinavia, because we have developed a way of working together. And you see, democracy, it moves so slowly that if you do very fast changes, then you can lose what you have tried to build up for hundreds of years.
The referendum affected many Norwegians who were themselves too young to vote. At a school in Bergen, I spoke to a group of working-class 16-year-olds who, as part of their studies, have been writing essays on the pros and cons of common market membership.
10 years ago, we had a discussion of Norway entering the common market, and it was just the same arguments used for Norway to get in, that we would face economical catastrophe. Yes, if not. But the 10 years have proved just the opposite.
I think it would be good to Norway to come into the common market, because sometime we have to go into the common market, and it's not sure that it will be so good for us in the future to come in.
You don't think that it's a bit ridiculous for a country with a smaller population as Norway to want to stand on her own?
Well, as I said before, 10 years has shown that we can stand on our own, and of course we will work together with the countries in Europe, even outside of the common market.
I think we have to stand on our own, because we have nothing to say if we come in the common market together with Germany and the other great countries like England.
It is, of course, where the economical power lies. It's those that decide what is to be done, and they will decide even if we are outside the common market, but it will be easier for us to control our own economical policy outside.
Do you think it's been a good thing that Norway has had a referendum, that the people have had a chance to vote on this?
Yes, I think that's correct, to give the people a chance to vote in this case.
Norway's common market conflict divided not just political parties, but often set friend against friend and close relatives against each other. Jakob Malm is a professor of medicine. His niece, Berliot Nygaard, is a veterinary surgeon. She sees the common market as no more than a rich man's club. He sees it as the guarantee of Norwegian security.
My picture of the world in 82, in 92, is perhaps a bit different from yours. And what I think is most important is maintaining a fair development between countries, between classes within countries. The government, the Yes people, tried to sell the idea of the common market through advertising, the same way as they tried to make the girls buy soap for laundry, for instance. And we wanted to make them decide on real political knowledge.
But you see, we also look towards the future, and we hope that this will be, in reality, a European community with other goals than just a common market, see? Against other trade regions of the world. Of course, economy is the base for security. It has been and it will always be. You can't be strong, you can't be secure without the financial basis.
The only thing is that we fear that the economical power and the political power is too closely linked in this European community, so that it will be very difficult if the good of the people opposes the good of the economists. And that is what we fear, and that's why we want to think differently.
Has the campaign itself, particularly where members of families disagree, been a very bitter campaign, would you say?
It is, I think, painful to feel that things that are very important for me and a view of reality that I feel is right is not understood by my uncle. And the other way around, I think also. I must admit, it is painful, but I think that through all this new thinking and all this engagement in this question, something good must come out.
What about the whole idea of a referendum? We in Britain have not had one, and there are people in Britain who feel we should have had one. Now, what do you feel?
I feel that it will be a very long time before we have any referendum in Norway, after this referendum.
Why?
Simply because there has been so much emotionalism and, to a certain extent, irrationalism and slogans, you know. And until we have really analyzed what effect has this kind of campaign had on the final result, we should never have a referendum, in my opinion.
In the early hours of Tuesday morning, Berliot Nygaard was among those celebrating the no victory. After more than 3 hours of tension, with the balance swinging first to no, then to yes, the outlying towns swung the vote back to no, this time for good. The final result being 53.5% no to 46.5% yes. In his room at party headquarters, Prime Minister Trygve Bratteli spoke ruefully of referendums in general.
There are many people in Britain who believe that it might have been a good idea for Britain to have had a chance, or still to have a chance, to express its opinion on this.
Well, I personally think Germany, that Great Britain should keep to their parliamentary system and not introduce referendum.
Do you feel that it will be unfortunate for Britain if Norway does not join the common market?
Well, in the European context, the most important is certainly that Great Britain became member of the common market. But it is not so important for Europe that Norway enter into it. But for Norway itself, it is my conviction that it is a pity if Norway does not join the common market.
This has been a bitter night for you personally, has it?
No. I am never bitter. I take all the events as they can.
Thank you, Prime Minister.
Mr. Bratteli left Labour Party headquarters to concede defeat in a broadcast to the nation. As he promised, he and his government will now resign. The voters of Norway had spoken clearly, but the method left some in doubt.
I would question now how good this referendum has been for the political system. I have never seen so much demagoguery and so much nationalism as we have seen in this case. I think there are too much emotions involved. I think at an ordinary elections there are much more decent arguments and a much more decent way of campaigning than we have seen here.
Do you feel on the evidence of what's happened in Norway that there would have been a case for Britain having had a referendum?
Well, if I was in the British government, I would not have advised it, at least. I must say the fact that people know so little about politics here, as we have seen now in this referendum in opinion polls, suggests to me that this is not the way of making such an important decision.
Nowhere was the result of Norway's referendum more eagerly awaited than in Denmark. And nowhere, as the news came through of Mr. Bratteli's defeat, were the shock waves so profound. Denmark has its own common market referendum next Monday. Immediately the Norwegian result was known, the Prime Minister suspended all foreign exchange dealings and repeated his warning that if Denmark fails to join the common market, she will have to devalue her currency. The Danish polls still show a majority in favour of saying yes on Monday. But the government's fear is that Norway's no may encourage Danish voters to do likewise. That fear is also the hope of anti-marketeers like Ferdi Jacobsen.
Mr. Jacobsen, what's your reaction to the result from Norway?
I'm glad. If the Norwegians had said yes, I think there would have been very little hope for no in Denmark. Now there is at any rate a fair chance.
What are your reasons for opposing the common market?
In my opinion, a condition for democracy is that people know each other, that people know the people they elect, and those elected have something to say. We do not know Italian or French, or for that sake also British political people. I do believe that democracy is really only possible within a nation.
Do you think it's a good idea that as complicated a question as this should be decided by referendum rather than by the representatives in parliament?
That is what I call democracy. It is the fate of the Danish people. I do believe that nobody can decide that better than the Danish people. I do not believe in experts which only understand prices. And I do not even believe in my
members
of parliament. Because you can see they divide, with few exceptions, according to the traditional party lines. In this dead earnest question, which has nothing to do with the program of political parties.
Do you think that it would have been wise for Britain to have had a referendum?
It is not a question of wisdom, it is a question of democracy. I think it would be more democratic.
Whether or not the anti-market celebrations in Oslo will be repeated next week in Copenhagen, what happened in Norway is something new in European politics. The voice of the people, say supporters of the referendum idea, has been heard. A referendum has overthrown a government and reversed a major policy decision. And those who want Britain to have a referendum on the common market have gained new ammunition now that Norway has said no.